championship basketball.
Right away, when you get to the site, you start feeling the pressure of the event and the tradition of the event, the incredible players that have played in the ACC.
You can't go through a childhood of loving the game without knowing about the granddaddy of them all, you know, the ACC basketball tournament.
When the tournament comes about, the ACC tournament, you have a huge spotlight on you, and your neighbors are looking at you, and it's a time to really shine.
At 82-80, State is the first champion of the new conference.
Here's his drive down, up for the shot. Oh, what a move!
In the corner to Walker, the jump in the air! Here's the bucket!
And that's it! The Blue Devils, under Mike Krzyzewski, have taken it.
2-1, there's the shot at the bucket!
Yes! Yes!
3 points,
yes!
But the Yellow Jackets have won the 1983 ACC Basketball Tournament Championship.
Just the interest and the excitement that's involved in the Atlantic Coast Conference Tournament is just, it's unequaled by any other tournament, I think, in the country.
There's great pressure on you, your teammates, the coaches, and you can see it, especially if you're in the finals. And he said, one game, it's a crapshoot. If you're playing against a team, they can get hot, and it's bye-bye, baby. That's it.
Long before the nation reveled in March Madness, there was the tournament. More than an event, it has been a battle to withstand the tremendous pressure and emerge as champion, to boast of being the best in the most competitive conference in the nation. This is the 40-year roller coaster ride built on pressure and pride. This is the story of the Atlantic Coast Conference Tournament.
This is where it all began, Reynolds Coliseum. They called it the Taj Mahal of the country, and it is in this very building that the Atlantic Coast Conference Basketball Tournament took its first steps towards becoming the national showcase that it is more than 40 years later. In 1954, on March 4th, the bold schools of the newly created ACC embarked on an endeavor that would ultimately prove to be the envy of the entire college basketball world. But things weren't always so perfect in ACC country. When the inaugural tournament rolled around, it was not met with much success at the box office. Despite ticket prices that were as low as $6 for a three-day tournament pass, and despite the fact that an energetic NC State coach named Everett Case was seen right here out in the lobby of Reynolds Coliseum handing out hundreds of tickets as a promotional tool, not even the first championship game was sold out back in 1954.
Faced with a public that was relatively uninterested in college basketball, Case went to work. He became part movie producer, choreographer, ringmaster in selling his dream, the tournament, to the public. A regular P.T. Barnum, Case took an athletic event in Reynolds Coliseum and turned it into a three-ring circus. The heroes of the hardwood introduced and bathed in all the drama by blaring bands and spotlights as they ran to center court, or should I say, center stage. Everett Case made ACC basketball more than a game. He made it an event.
When he brought basketball to the state of North Carolina, he packaged it in such a way that made it more attractive for the fans. He had the big Coliseum, the organ music, the halftime shows, the whole bit. And this had never been done before. Basketball was sort of a second-class citizen. He changed all that.
Case's powerhouse NC State team had won 6 of the last 7 conference tournaments, and judging by his early approach to the ACC tournament, he was determined to have his Wolfpack pick up where they had left off.
Prior to tournament time, they put us in a hotel. We had our breakfast, our lunch, and our dinners, and we went over films. It was strictly basketball. It was a business.
Despite having the home court advantage, the Wolfpack didn't have an easy road to the first ACC championship game, beating North Carolina by only 1 point and top-seeded Duke by just 4.
Wake Forest versus State in the tourney final to decide the first champion of the new Atlantic Coast Conference.
The Wolfpack, who had lost the previous year's Southern Conference championship to the Demon Deacons, were looking for sweet revenge in the first ACC title game. The Pack almost fell victim again as Wake Forest had chances to win at the end of regulation. But in overtime, State's Dick Tyler rebounded his own shot for the deciding basket as the Wolfpack won 82-80.
State is the first champion of the new conference.
Case and his assistants kept their winning formula out of sight and behind closed doors. As the Wolfpack steamrolled to their second and third consecutive championships, they made it look easy, winning six games over the next 2 years by an average of 13 points. But in fact, they had completed an ACC three-peat that would be achieved only once more in the tournament's next 37 years. The Pack's M&M boys, lightning-quick backcourt mates John Maglio and Vic Maledet, were the keys to Case's running offense and trademark full-court pressure defense. 6'9 center Ronnie Shavlik, a three-time all-tournament player and future All-American, earned MVP honors in 55. His 24-point, 21-rebound performance against Duke in the final topped off a tournament in which he had 54 rebounds. Still a record. Shavlik was all-tournament again the following year, despite playing with a cast on his broken wrist, as the sharpshooting Maledek walked away with MVP honors. The three-time All-ACC guard scored 32 points in the championship win over Wake Forest. With Everett Case keeping the Wolfpack trophy case full, the tournament's popularity was growing, especially with the home fans in Raleigh. In fact, for the moment at least, it looked as if it would take nothing short of a miracle to overcome the Wolfpack's three-year dominance of the ACC. In 1957, that miracle arrived. North Carolina coach Frank McGuire, a longtime nemesis of Case, took his Tar Heels into the ACC tournament after an undefeated regular season. For the Heels, the pressure was excruciating. Just one loss and it would be all over. Wash the jerseys and head home. Right then, there were probably more than a few Tar Heel fans who felt that the conference was hurting itself with its winner-take-all postseason tournament. The first round saw South Carolina All-American Grady Wallace set the single-game scoring record with 41 points in a win over Duke. Wallace and North Carolina's Lenny Rosenbluth finished 1-2 respectively in the ACC in scoring, so all eyes were watching to see how the Tar Heel All-American would respond to the challenge in the following game.
My mom and dad were down for the game, and my father said, "Now, if he can do it, you can do it."
Rosenbluth proved father knows best as he poured in 45 points in the win over Clemson, a scoring total that still stands as a tournament record. But the excitement was just beginning for Rosenbluth and his teammates. In the semifinals, the Tar Heels faced a Wake Forest team they had defeated three times in the regular season. Yet UNC trailed the Demon Deacons by 1 point with time running out. What happened next is still regarded as one of the most controversial calls in ACC tournament history.
We had a man in front of Rosenbluth and a man behind him because he could shoot the eyes out of him. He couldn't guard this camera I'm looking in, but he could shoot it.
I made a cut toward the foul line, and I believe Wendell Carr bumped me. The minute I felt the bump, I knew the whistle was going, and I threw up a hook shot. Now, that was, a lot of people say, well, you know, you hooked one in from the foul line. Well, if I took a shot from the foul line, McGuire would have killed me.
Rosenbluth was our bread and butter when it came to taking a shot. And we just set it up where he came across from the corner into the pivot and took a hook shot. And his hook shot was so perfect, and it went in like it had eyes. And of course, Bones, I don't know what he was complaining about. He walked. I understand Bones chased the referees all night and couldn't find them. Yeah, he was really upset.
I'm good friends with the guy that called the foul right now. You know, he lives here in Raleigh. And he made a decision. I mean, he's not going to try to cheat you. He either saw it that way, and you know, and we saw it another way.
Now that I've mellowed over the years, we couldn't have won a national championship, and North Carolina did win it that year, so it worked out okay, I think.
The win put the Tar Heels into the championship game, where McGuire's miracle stayed alive. Rosenbluth had 38 more points in UNC's win over South Carolina, giving him an incredible total of 106 points for the tournament. Another record yet to be broken. The Tar Heels went on to win the national championship in 1957 with an undefeated record. The ACC's first title in just its fourth year brought respectability to the young conference. But Everett Case continued to be the ultimate promoter, trying to concoct at least one more way to attract attention to ACC basketball. For years, Case prodded UNC's McGuire to exaggerate what was seen as a long-running feud between two of the ACC's most successful programs.
Oddly enough, I was very friendly with Everett, and I'd go over, I'd take Frankie for a ride on Sundays, and I'd go over and sit with Everett Case at his home. And Everett used to say to me, don't shake hands with me on the court. Let these people think we're mad at one another. This is the truth. I said, nothing doing, I'll shake it. He said, you can shake hands with me downstairs. He wanted to keep this thing going. McGuire was mad at Everett Case, but it wasn't.
Even with the Tar Heels' national title, there was still talk about the fairness of the ACC's do-or-die tournament.
I believe that my statement might have been it was a $64,000 farce. The tournament itself was by no means a farce. The tournament was a great basketball tournament. The thing that I said was a farce about it was the pressure that was put on that ball club and the elimination of the other teams not being allowed to go to the other tournament.
Milliken didn't have too much to complain about in 1958 when his Terrapins advanced to the championship against North Carolina. When the Tar Heels jumped out to a 7-point halftime lead, it looked like a second straight title. But the Terrapins got hot in the second half, shooting over 60% on the way to their first ACC championship. In fact, Maryland became the only non-Big Four team to win an ACC tournament in the league's first 17 years. A year later, the ACC title returned to familiar ground as NC State reclaimed the top spot. Still playing in the friendly confines of Reynolds Coliseum, the Wolfpack close out the decade defeating McGuire and the Tar Heels in the championship game by a whopping 80-56 margin. It was State's fourth conference title in 6 years. The Wolfpack, though, couldn't advance to NCAA play because they were on probation. Knowing that his UNC team would represent the league in the NCAA tournament, McGuire rested his Tar Heel starters in the title game, drawing the wrath of those in attendance and prompting one fan to protest by finding and shutting off the Coliseum lights, causing an 8-minute delay.
Well, that was unusual. They accused some rabid North Carolina fan of pulling the lights, and maybe they thought they could start the game over from scratch.
Reveling in their latest tournament victory, one that would prove to be Case's last, the Wolfpack called a timeout with 4 seconds remaining and a 24-point lead. It proved to be a worthy pause. Despite their dominance in the 50s and the continuation of the tournament in Raleigh, the Wolfpack wouldn't return to the top of the ACC for another 6 years. As the ACC tournament entered its second decade, the decline of the host Wolfpack coincided with the rise of another stop along Tobacco Road, the Duke Blue Devils. Just as Everett Case and the Wolfpack won 4 conference titles in the 50s, so did Vic Bubas and the Blue Devils in the 60s. A former assistant under Case, Bubas ended his first year at Duke with a 7-7 conference record, but the Blue Devils came alive in the 1960 tournament with 30 points from center Carol Youngkin. They beat the regular season champs UNC by 2 points in the semifinals. It was like Christmas in March, Bubas said. Then they got 22 points from tournament MVP Doug Kitzler in the finals to defeat Wake Forest 63-59. The win gave Duke its first ACC championship and left the Deacons as the only Big Four school that had yet to win the conference crown. But that didn't last long. Under coach Bones McKinney, a former NC State and UNC player, and behind All-American center Len Chapel, Wake Forest captured the next 2 ACC tournaments. Chapel averaged 34 points a game in 61 and 29 points the following year, in becoming the first of only 3 players in tournament history to win back-to-back Most Valuable Player awards. To this day, Chapel's 220 career tournament points stands as an all-time record, despite the fact that before 1974, players were allowed only 3 years of varsity competition.
But people would say, you know, I don't think he's that good. All he can do is shoot, score, and rebound. And I used to think about that. I said, well, you know, those are 3 pretty good assets for a player to have.
In the 61 championship game, Chapel had 33 points as Wake Forest avenged their loss to Duke the year before with a 15-point win. The 1962 championship featured the defending champs led by Chapel and guard Billy Packer against a Cinderella team, Press Maravich's Clemson squad. The Tigers were the number 6 seed, but they upset North Carolina State in the first round and second-seeded Duke in the semifinals.
But it's one of those games where maybe a team wasn't ready. They're looking past somebody. I really think Duke was looking forward to playing Wake Forest. I think everybody assumed that would be the final. Maravich was a very good motivator. He knew a lot about the game. And he just told us we didn't have anything to lose.
Wake Forest ended the Tigers' dream run as Chapel and Packer combined for 52 points, and the Deacons won their second straight conference title. Perhaps the pressure of the ACC tournament has never been greater than it was in 1963. Vic Bubas's Blue Devils had defeated their conference foes by an average of 17 points a game in the regular season. They carried a 14-0 conference record into Raleigh. They realized it didn't mean a thing unless they won three more games.
You know, people say there's a lot of pressure in basketball now. I'm going to reconstruct something for you. I'll tell you what pressure is all about. Pressure is being an undefeated team in the ACC with one team going to the NCAA, no teams allowed to go to the NIT, not playing on your home court and knowing in advance that three teams might hold the ball on you, and there is no shot clock. Now, if you want to understand what pressure is, try that one on for size.
Fortunately for Bubas, he had one of the greatest players in ACC tournament history on his side. The Blue Devils were in another dogfight with defending champion Wake Forest. Duke trailed by four at half and continued to stumble early in the second half when senior All-American Art Heyman decided to take matters into his own hands.
Wake Forest was coming back a little and we had a timeout, and usually I never talk or no one ever talks in the huddle. So I said, "Coach, just tell Jeff to get the ball, take it out, give me the ball, and everybody get out of the way, and I'll go into the basket." And I got a three-point play and we just blew him out after that.
The Blue Devils' 68-57 victory and Heyman's MVP performance on the way to National Player of the Year honors secured his place as one of the best players in tournament history. Heyman's career marks of 191 points and 104 rebounds still rank among the top five of all time. And his three first-team all-tournament selections put him in an elite class that includes only seven other players. Two of those seven, Jeff Mullins and Bob Verga, followed in Heyman's footsteps at Duke and helped continue the Blue Devils' run at the top of the ACC for years to come. It was Mullins' turn in 64. When he earned tournament MVP honors as Duke dominated the ACC tournament like no team had ever done before or since, winning three games by an average of 23 points a game and giving Bubas his third league title. The ACC tournament's popularity continued to grow in 1965, the first year that all three rounds were sold out, in what turned out to be a tribute to Everett Case, who retired earlier in the season because of health problems. NC State won the tournament by defeating Duke 91-85. State's Press Maravich, who had been elevated from assistant in Case's absence, became the second and last rookie coach to lead his team to a conference crown. An unsung reserve Larry Worsley poured in 30 points on 14 of 19 shooting in the final to earn MVP honors and the first ever Everett Case Award, so named to honor the man who had conceived and worked so hard to ensure the success of this incredible tournament.
Just as soon as the ball game was over, I'll never get it. I got an older brother, David, lives in Garner, North Carolina. He came up to me, and this was right after the game, and I was just excited the fact we had won. I didn't have an idea how many points I'd scored. I mean, I was just concerned about trying to win. And my brother said, "Larry, you're going to get the most valuable player." I said, "No, I'm not going to get it." He said, "Yes, you are. You're going to win it. You're going to have to win it." And I got to thinking about it then, and sure enough, you know, later on they announced it.
Worsley's moment became even more special as he is still the only non-starter to ever win the award, along with being the only one to receive it from Case himself.
It was just a great feeling. Matter of fact, I'll be honest, my wife and I, we didn't even go to sleep all night. We stayed up all night long.
After the game, Wolfpack players hoisted Maravich on their shoulders to cut down one net. Caught up in the moment, he kissed the rim. Down court, the players found Case, lifted and carried him onto the court. His health sapped by cancer, but nothing could rob him of his spirit. An incredible scene. This would be his last tournament, his last chance to breathe in all the energy, the excitement, the drama of a tournament that he had created some 11 years before. The 1966 tournament distinctively marked an end of a tradition. It was the last of 13 tournaments in the capital city. On the court, the 66 tournament also provided Duke with another title. It was the fourth and final tournament championship for Bubas, tying him with his mentor Case for most ACC titles. But it wasn't easy. In one of the more talked about games in tournament history, UNC's coach Dean Smith opened up the semifinal matchup with the Blue Devils in a delay offense. With no shot clock, the delay turned into an all-out stall. On a number of occasions, the Tar Heels held the ball for as much as 4 minutes at a time. With 10 minutes left in the game, the Heels led by 5, 17-12. Then, Duke made a run and with less than 2 minutes to go, knotted the score at 20. On the next possession, the Blue Devils decided to give the Heels a taste of their own medicine. Holding the ball for the last shot, Duke's Mike Lewis was fouled with only 4 seconds remaining. Converting the second free throw, the Blue Devils escaped with a 21-20 win. Duke's anticlimactic 71-66 win over NC State in their final gave Duke and Bubas their fourth ACC crown in 7 years. The Blue Devil coach would go on to finish his amazing 10-year career with 8 championship game appearances and a sparkling 22-6 record in the ACC tournament, a mark that still remains the best in history. 1967 brought about the first change of venue in tournament history. That year's tournament marked a much-anticipated move from Raleigh, where it had been for the first 13 years of its existence, to the Greensboro Coliseum, where it would be played for 14 of the next 27 years, most recently in 1988. The 14 years in Greensboro would span 3 decades and represented the longest tenure of any ACC tournament site. Like Reynolds and Raleigh, this Greensboro Coliseum would serve up a new generation of ACC fans, players, and coaches with tournament thrills and memories.
And I really thought that Greensboro was a great city for the tournament. Not that Charlotte is not, just that Greensboro embraced it, it hugged it, it kind of patted it on the cheek and kissed it all over, and that was great. I'll always, you know, as long as I'm in the league, be very beholden to the people of Greensboro.
The change in locations also represented another changing of the guard. Just as Duke's Vic Bubas had followed the success of NC State's Everett Case, North Carolina's Dean Smith overwhelmed Bubas and the rest of the league's coaches by developing the Tar Heels into the most successful team in ACC tournament history. Today, UNC's incredible total of 12 ACC titles ranks as the most in league history. Among other ACC schools, only NC State with 10 and Duke with 9 have more than 3 ACC crowns. And among head coaches, Smith's total of 11 ACC titles dwarfs the numbers of his closest competitors, fellow legends Case and Bubas, who had 4 apiece. The Tar Heels win in 67 marked the first of 3 consecutive tournament titles, a feat that hadn't been accomplished since Case and the Wolfpack won the first 3 tournaments, and an accomplishment that hasn't been matched since. During the 3-year run, Smith and the Tar Heels finished first in the ACC regular season, only to face trips to Greensboro and then to Charlotte to earn the league title. The pressure to win the ACC championship was as powerful as ever. Indeed, in some ways, if you survived the ACC tournament, the NCAAs were just icing on the cake.
And they always talk about pressure, you know, in the NCAA tournament. Nothing could be like the pressure it was to win the regular season ACC and then have to win the tournament in order to go anywhere.
After we won the ACC tournament in those years, we were so relieved. I'd tell them, it's like bowl games. This is gravy now. Nothing to worry about. Have some fun. And so we'd play volleyball on Monday. Just work out that way.
One of Smith's championship volleyball players was also one of the best tournament performers. UNC's Larry Miller, or Captain Clutch, as he was called, for his big game performances, averaged 26 points in 1967 and 25 in 68 to become only the second of 3 players ever to win back-to-back Most Valuable Player awards.
Probably Larry Miller was probably had the biggest heart of any basketball player I've ever seen or been associated with. Larry wouldn't let you lose. He wasn't the most physically gifted, I think, with any one part of his game, but his heart was probably as big as his chest, and he did whatever it took.
In the 67 final win over Duke, the All-American left-hander with the picture-perfect jump shot canned 13 of 14 field goals and finished with 32 points, at 11 rebounds, and it ranks as one of the greatest single-game performances in tournament history. In 68, the tournament moved to Charlotte for 3 years. New town, same results, as Larry Miller knocked down 21 points and the Tar Heels rolled to the biggest title game blowout in history and 87-50 pasting of NC State. That same tournament also featured one of the most bizarre games in tournament history. In 66, the Duke-UNC game was slow. The 68 semifinal game between Duke and NC State was a crawl, prompting radio announcer Bill Curry to call the action about as exciting as artificial insemination. The main characters were Duke coach Vic Bubas and NC State coach Norm Sloan, who remembered that the fast-paced Blue Devils had walloped his Wolfpack twice during the regular season and wasn't about to let it happen again.
And Mike Lewis averaged over 20 rebounds against us and near 20 points. I can't remember if it was over or under. And so, but we didn't plan to hold the ball, but what we planned to do was pull him away from the basket to open up the middle for some of the rest of us. And he wouldn't come out.
Duke led at halftime 4-2, and Sloan stayed with the delay in the second half. In one stretch, State's Bill Kretzer held the ball for 14 straight minutes.
Fortunately, the ball was right in front of me, and I was standing there talking. Eddie Biedenbaugh was the kid holding the ball for us most of the time, and I'm carrying on a conversation with him and carrying on a conversation with the other players, and the Duke players were coming up and listening to our conversation, kind of acting it up a little bit. Tony Baroni, who later on went into college coaching himself, was really having a big time with it. He was about 5'5". And this game rolled down to about 3 minutes, and we're sitting there on 8-6. We're down, and so I called Biedenbaugh over and I said, just Eddie, get the basketball at about 2 minutes and make something happen. And he ran away and came back and he says, you want me to call timeout? I said, no. And Brony was standing there listening, you know, and laughing, having a big time. I said, no, don't call timeout. If you call timeout, they'll take that midget out and put a man in. I said, no, I want you scoring on him. I was mad at the time because the guy was playing with us a little bit. Sure enough, Eddie took the basketball, dribbled down the corner, and shot a jumper right in over the top of him, tied the ball game up 8-8. And psychologically, from that point on, it fell our way, and we wound up winning 12-10.
There were no slowdowns the next year in what proved to be an electrifying championship game, punctuated by an individual performance that still ranks as one of the best. North Carolina's march to a third straight conference crown was threatened only in the final game, where Duke jumped out to a 9-point halftime lead and seemed to have the game well in control. What followed was a second half performance by UNC guard Charlie Scott that was worthy of his nickname, Great Scott.
When you get a game and you're down at halftime and you're in a win or lose circumstance, or you know you don't go any further, you know, sometimes you look within yourself to see what you can pull out to, you know, pull up within yourself to, you know, to win a game.
Inside, outside, everywhere Scott shot, he found what he was looking for. In a sharp shooting display that ranks with one of the best in the history of college basketball, Scott scored 28 points in the second half and finished the night with 40 points on 17 of 23 shooting.
Broken up by Bunning, recaptured by Scott. Here's his drive down, up for the shot. Oh, what a move!
It was an MVP performance that UNC's Dean Smith and Duke's Vic Bubas accurately called one of the greatest individual displays ever.
And I'm going to tell you, we had everybody else beat. We had everybody on their team beat. Thought we had their coaches beat. We didn't have Charlie Scott beat. Charlie got 40 from, you know, hitting what seemed like 40-foot jump shots going to his left, and we're bouncing him all over the place, and he's making them, and they just gave the ball to him, which was good for them. And it's just one of those things.
Coach Smith would never say get the ball to anyone. I mean, that's not in a Coach Smith vocabulary. I mean, I think that my teammates more or less took it upon themselves to get the ball to me at that particular time. I don't even know if Coach Smith even knew I was the one scoring all the points at the time. You know, if he did, he might have sat me down. But Coach Smith was still calling plays, and it just so happened when it came time to shoot, I had the ball at that particular time in the game.
The year after North Carolina completed their three-year sweep of the tournament, South Carolina grabbed all of the headlines. The Gamecocks went into the 1970 tournament sporting a 14-0 conference record. Two other teams, North Carolina in 1957 and Duke in 1963, managed to win the tournament after finishing the regular season undefeated in conference play. South Carolina, though, wouldn't be so lucky. Frank McGuire was back in the league, this time coaching South Carolina. His Gamecocks advanced to the ACC Finals in a double overtime game with NC State. Gamecock guard Bobby Kremins, who would go on to make his mark in the ACC coaching ranks, was working the backcourt with fellow guard and ACC Player of the Year John Roach. With less than a minute to play in the second overtime, South Carolina had the ball in a one-point lead. Then came a moment that many, especially Kremins himself, will never forget.
Yeah, we were up 1 point with 30 seconds to go, and we had the basketball, and we were in a delay game. And I remember John throwing the ball to me, and I went to receive it, and there was a collision with Ed Leftwich and myself. And the ball popped loose and went down the court, and Leftwich went after it and got it and laid the ball in the basket. And at that moment, I think everybody just froze. The fans were going hysterical, particularly the NC State fans. And I think we were all in a little bit of shock.
And Bobby played with his heart. If ever a fella had a heart that was, you know, not afraid of anything. And I never considered. I only found out like later years that Bobby thought that he had lost the game. He was nuts. Yeah, it wasn't Bobby.
And I think a lot of players on the team felt that loss very strongly, perhaps for years to come. I know I've talked to Bobby Kremins about it, and he says he still feels some pangs of disappointment at that, and I must say I do as well. So that was a very difficult end to a very fine season.
3-point lead. Seconds clicking away, and they're going to let Roach shoot, and there it is. North Carolina State is the Atlantic Coast Conference champion for 1970 with a dramatic double overtime victory over nationally third-ranked South Carolina in a stunning upset.
For South Carolina, the tournament's loss left the Gamecock team and fans devastated. For Bobby Kremins, the reality was especially painful. Senior, an undefeated conference record, strange ending, and then after all the practice, all the play, over. End of season, end of career. The feisty Gamecocks made one last run at an ACC championship in 1971 when the tournament moved back to Greensboro for 5 years. In what turned out to be South Carolina's final season in the Atlantic Coast Conference, the Gamecocks ripped through Maryland and NC State to set up a showdown with top-seeded North Carolina in the championship game. McGuire's squad shot only 28% against his former team, but the Gamecocks trailed by only 1 point in the final seconds, when another one of the ACC tournament's unforgettable moments arrived. It was probably the most famous jump ball in ACC history when UNC's Lee Dedman, a 6'10" center, stepped into the center circle against USC's 6'3" guard, Kevin Joyce. It looked like it would take another McGuire miracle for the Gamecocks to finally capture the conference crown. Of course, as it's been proven again and again in the tournament, miracles do happen.
Kevin Joyce, all through high school, was the center, really. And he could jump. He had tremendous legs. Now, Dedman is a boy about 6'11". I said that I didn't expect Kevin to outjump him. I really didn't. But he got the tap. Tommy Owens, when he got the ball underneath, we were all surprised. And we put the ball in the basket. Those things happen. I wonder what Deans thought was, he probably wanted to strangle about four of his players.
I think over the years I've convinced myself that what happened didn't happen, and I've got a good story for it. We called a couple timeouts, and Coach had diagrammed a play, very calm, that we had practiced this and practiced the day before. And the tip went up, and I still think I had my hand on the ball, and Kevin had his hand on mine. And I think it just went the wrong spot.
With South Carolina's departure, 1972 marked the first time the tournament had a first-round bye. The top-seeded Tar Heels needed to win only two games to claim the conference championship. Behind All-America forward Bob McAdoo, UNC did just that, dispatching Duke and then Maryland handily to win their fifth ACC crown. The 1973 and 74 seasons marked the reign of one of the most dominant teams and two of the most dominant players in ACC tournament history. During an amazing two-year run that saw Norm Sloan's NC State squad go 57-1, the Wolfpack did in two seasons what had only been done twice in history. They went through the conference regular season and the tournament undefeated, becoming the only team in the 70s to post back-to-back ACC championships. The Wolfpack were led by David Thompson, who became the fifth player to earn three consecutive first-team all-tournament honors. And Tom Burleson, who secured his place in ACC tournament history by becoming the last of only three players to win back-to-back MVP honors. Ironically, the 1973 tournament may be most remembered for a seemingly innocent first-round matchup between North Carolina, ranked eighth nationally, and Wake Forest, ranked last in the ACC. In one of the most incredible plays in league history, the Demon Deacons were trying to become the first last-seeded team to ever win a tournament game. Trailing by 2 points with only 1 second remaining in regulation, Deacons coach Carl Tacy called the timeout and planned what would turn out to be a play for the ages.
Coach Tacy says, all right, who can throw a baseball pass? And I said, I can't. And then he proceeded to show us what to do, but it wasn't anything we had ever practiced. And so we went out there and I took the ball and I threw the ball the full length of the court, and one thing led to another. Lee Foy called it and shot it, and it went into overtime. And at that point, it was like coming from the depths of to the very heights. So the emotion really carried us into the overtime. It wasn't until later, looking at the films and so forth, that I realized as I threw that pass at the end of the regulation, my foot was on the line. Didn't matter. We won, you know.
In the 1974 tournament, there was no such craziness to take away the spotlight from the champion Wolfpack. On March 9th, in the Greensboro Coliseum, NC State and Maryland clashed in the ACC tournament final in an epic battle that is still considered the greatest game in ACC history and one of the greatest in all of college basketball. With the ACC's one and only NCAA bid at stake, the Wolfpack and Terrapins, two of the top teams in the nation, put on a display that would leave participants and spectators alike searching for superlatives for years to come.
You got the feeling playing in that game that you were going to have to play better maybe than you had ever played before, both individually and as a team, or your season was going to come to an end that evening, because that's just how good Maryland was playing.
The storyline for this unprecedented battle was actually set weeks earlier when Maryland center Len Elmore and State's Burleson met in the regular season.
The last game we played in North Carolina State was toward the end of the year. Lenny had a really good game and outplayed Tommy Burleson very badly. Tommy didn't have a very good game. Lenny had a real good game. So after the game, Lenny comes out and says, I guess it's certain now who's the best center in the ACC. And I got on him about it then. I said, Lenny, we got to play these guys again in the tournament. You shouldn't have said that. He said, I know, coach, but a guy just tricked me into saying it.
Len Elmore had made the comments that he was, 10 times the player that I was and everything, and that I wasn't fit to carry his shoes into the gym, that he deserved the first team all ACC and I deserved to be on second team all ACC. Coach Sloan had a copy of that article that Elmore, after the game in Raleigh, he had a copy of that article taped in my locker the next day, and it remained there until after the NCAA tournament was over.
He was fired up. I could tell when he ran out for the tip-off, he did this, and so I said, oh my gosh, he's got that clipping.
In a game that involved no fewer than six All-Americans, David Thompson, Monty Tau, and Burleson of State, and Tom McMillan, John Lucas, and Elmore of Maryland, the 7'4" Burleson clearly stood above the rest. With the Terrapins overloading their defense to slow Thompson, the National Player of the Year, the Wolfpack senior center had a career-high 38 points on remarkable 18 of 25 shooting and 13 rebounds. When Monty Tau hit two free throws with 6 seconds left in overtime, State had survived 103-100 in a thriller that unfortunately left a powerful 23-5 Maryland team home for the postseason, but sent the Wolfpack onto the ACC's long-awaited second national championship.
It seems like I take the blame for Tom Burleson having a good game, and if that be the case, so be it. I'm in a position now where I can look back on it and smile, but the last time I checked, basketball was a team game, and I believe that we as a team focused so much on certain people and forgot about others that we just didn't realize that NC State was as well-rounded a team as they were, and obviously it proved to be the case in that final game.
Part of the fallout from the 74 championship game came from the NCAA tournament committee. Finally, after years of complaints from what had become the nation's strongest conference, the NCAA's expanded to 32 teams and allowed up to two schools from any one conference.
The famous game with NC State in the finals of the tournament probably was the most important game ever played in ACC tournament history, in that it changed the way college basketball is played. Maryland was clearly no worse than the third best team in the country. Lefty knew that. Lefty not only probably would have gone to a Final Four had he been eligible that year, he very well may have won the national championship. So I think Lefty had his greatest impact in college basketball in a losing game in the ACC tournament.
While no one game may ever match the one night excitement of the 74 title game, the 1975 ACC tournament as a whole came close.
Can you believe that?
In the biggest nail-biting weekend on record, six games were decided by a total of 20 points. Dean Smith's North Carolina team survived some tough competition and two nerve-wracking overtime games with a freshman point guard, no less, for Smith's record fifth conference championship. In just the third year of freshman eligibility, each ACC team had at least one rookie in its starting lineup for the tournament. The brightest new star was Tar Heel point guard Phil Ford, who averaged 26 points a game and ran the famed Four Corners offense to near perfection in leading UNC to its sixth ACC championship.
I really didn't think about the pressure. I was just having fun playing basketball, and I was just happy to be out there and being able to compete with players that I had watched growing up in high school and junior high, and just being able to be on the same floor with them.
Well, I love Phil Ford. I think if I had to draw up a player that I wanted, you know, a player to be like, it'd be like Phil Ford, the competitor. I just think he might be the greatest competitor that ever played in the league. I mean, he hated to lose. He'd do anything to win.
Ford's remarkable performance in 75 earned him MVP honors, making him the first of only two first-year players to win the Case Award. But Ford almost didn't get a chance to make history. In the Tar Heels' first-round matchup with lowly Wake Forest, only another last-minute freak play prevented the Demon Deacons from scoring another upset of UNC. In one of the most talked-about plays in tournament history, Wake Forest had a four-point lead in the final minute when the Deacons Skip Brown broke free for a full-court pass and layup that seemed to seal a Wake victory.
Fred Heichel is the referee in the game, or one of the officials. Fred Heichel runs over to the scores table, and I'm later told by the folks who were at the scores table, he did not come over to the table and say, "Did that ball touch that scoreboard?" He came over and made a definite statement. That ball hit the scoreboard. How much time did we lose?
I would not have ever been able to catch the pass if it hit the scoreboard. Just the way the trajectory of the ball traveling through the air, it would not have, could not have made it to me. that was the thing I remember most about the ACC tournament, and one I don't like to remember.
Norval Nave, to this day, the commissioner of officials had proven through a physicist that ball did hit high up there at the scoreboard. And you know, one of the people that are mad about it, they should blame the guy for missing two one-on-ones instead of blaming the referee's call whether it hit a scoreboard or not.
The final reading on that scoreboard, North Carolina 101, Wake Forest 100. The Tar Heels went on to win the tournament by stopping NC State's attempt for a third straight title. There was no such controversy surrounding the 1976 tournament. In what was the first of three crazy trips to Landover, Maryland, the ACC's famous March Showcase left the state of North Carolina for the first time. And the lowly Virginia Cavaliers decided to throw a surprise party to commemorate the occasion. Prior to 1976, no team lower than a fourth seed had ever won the ACC tournament. Additionally, Virginia had never won an ACC title. All the six-seeded Cavaliers had to do to change all that was beat three nationally ranked teams, number 17 NC State, ninth ranked Maryland, and third ranked North Carolina.
The fact that we had lost all three of those teams twice during the regular season just meant that we had a lot of experience in knowing what not to do, and hopefully we do the right things in the tournament, and we did. We played a great tournament.
The greatest of the great for Virginia was senior forward Wally Walker, who surprised just about everyone in ACC country with one of the greatest all-around performances in tournament history.
In the corner to Walker, the jump in the air, in the bucket. Hang on, Grandpa, we got a barn burner going here tonight.
When Virginia upset number one seed North Carolina in the finals, Wonderful Wally, as the Virginia faithful called him, put up some impressive numbers. He scored 73 points on sizzling 28 of 41 shooting and grabbed 21 rebounds over the three games as the Cavaliers won their first and only ACC title. Walker might have gotten some of his incentive for his great play from being left off the All-ACC first team.
I thought I deserved to be first team All-League, but probably so did 10 other guys. So I went in the tournament very loose, and I don't say I went in with a vendetta, but I just wanted to continue an extension of the good senior year that I had, and I did go in with complete confidence that I'd been playing well, and just that carried over, and actually on a shooting percentage basis, it took it up a notch.
Unbelievable bedlam here! This place has just gone wild!
That's probably about as good a tournament performance as I've ever seen under the kind of pressure that he was under against that caliber of competition all three games. So 120 minutes of just absolutely superb basketball by our team, but more so by Wally Walker, who was MVP in the tournament. For 3 days, Wally's performance in that tournament was spectacular.
Last place Virginia was looking for another miracle in 1977 when the Cavs returned to the championship game and another matchup with North Carolina. This time, though, it was the Tar Heels who pulled together when they needed it most. UNC entered the title matchup without starter Tommy Lagarde and with sharpshooter Walter Davis ineffective due to a broken finger suffered in the semifinals. When starters Phil Ford and Michael Korn fouled out against the Cavs, an unlikely hero stepped forward. Tar Heel John Kuster, a steady but unspectacular player through his college career, the senior point guard scored 14 points in the title game and, in Ford's absence, worked UNC's four corners offense perfectly on his way to MVP honors. In 1978, just when many thought the tournament couldn't get any bigger, it did. ABC's Wide World of Sports, attracted by the ACC's increasingly lofty standing in the college basketball world, decided to air the title game on national television for the first time. When it turned out to be Duke and Wake Forest in the final, viewers from coast to coast were treated to their first glimpse of the ACC tournament and Blue Devil coach Bill Foster's latest contribution to American fashion, his lucky plaid suit.
And then when we started winning, he just, you know, kept the same suit on for 8 games and all the way up until the finals. I don't know if he threw it out after it was, you know, over with. It was probably tired of being worn, needed a rest in the back of the closet for a while.
Duke, which had been the ACC doormat just a year before, cruised to victory over the Demon Deacons behind Foster's suit and the dominance of sophomore center Mike Jaminski's 25 points and 16 rebounds. Junior Jim Spanarkel was named MVP on a team that also received major contributions from freshman forwards Gene Banks and Kenny Dennard. Like many ACC teams before then, the red-hot Blue Devils used their tournament victory as a springboard to success, from a last-place finish in 1977 to the conference's 11th Final Four appearance in a span of 17 years.
So the pieces came together, though. It just exploded. I think we went from, you know, the bottom to the top to the penthouse in 1 year, and we just kept going, kept getting more confidence and kept winning. And, you know, the team just really gelled and everything went together at one time. It was amazing.
North Carolina interrupted the Blue Devils' return to the top by beating them in the 79 final behind MVP Dudley Bradley. But that same Duke cast of Jaminski, Banks, and Dennard returned the favor in 1980. Operating without the bye system because of the addition of Georgia Tech as the ACC's eighth member, the sixth-seeded Blue Devils shocked second-seeded UNC in the semifinals. That set up a championship game showdown with regular season winner Maryland. Although a blizzard in Greensboro kept attendance down, those who did make it through the snow witnessed one of the most exciting finishes in ACC tournament play. The surprising Blue Devils trailed by only one as the game entered the final minute. After a Jaminski tip-in gave the Blue Devils the lead, Maryland came down court for one last shot.
We know that the ball is going to go to Albert King. He'd had such a great tournament that year. And he came, got the ball, turned around, had a good look at the basket. Buck Williams, who was one of the best rebounders in the ACC at the time, had great position underneath, and Kenny just took him out.
I did not undercut Buck Williams. I hope people will take the time to understand the laws of physics. Two strong men, 6'8", pushing each other, pushing back and forth, a chess game, a physical chess game. And then, of course, Buck jumped up in the air. Where was I to go? Except to go under him, which made it look like I undercut him. But I didn't. And that's why there was no foul called.
because I think one of those referees was a physics major in college, and he understood the principles. Now, that was great news and great pub that, hey, Kenny Denard undercut Buck Williams to win the game. But that's just not the truth, and I'm glad I get to set the record straight.
You know, I don't ever blame games on officials, and because they've got a tough job. In fact, to be honest with you, I didn't even see it. You know, I thought Buck had a good chance to tip in the winning basket, which he was right underneath the basket, and I think Kenny Denard rode him out of there. It was obviously a foul, but I didn't even know it at the time. You know, I got in the locker room, somebody said, Buck said, he got fouled me, coach, he rode me out. I said, I get out of here, we lost, forget about it, we'll, you know, get him next year or whatever I said. And then somebody brought in a camera, you know, a camera crew and said, look at this. And I said, hey, you did kind of get fouled, Buck. But, you know, that happens. I mean, we probably foul them sometime during the course of the game, too, so it all evens up. But it was a tough call, but one that the officials missed, I guess.
I'm sure the Maryland fans thought it was a foul, and I'm sure the Duke fans thought it was a textbook example of blocking out under the basket.
The 1981 tournament marked a return to Landover, where a three-day crowd of more than 76,000 watched UNC earn their ninth ACC title behind freshman center Sam Perkins. Silent Sam became only the second and last rookie to win the Case Award, and the Tar Heels went all the way to the national finals before losing to Indiana. In 1982, Virginia's Ralph Sampson stood between UNC and another ACC title. This game had it all. Sampson, who would go on to repeat as National Player of the Year as a junior, Tar Heel All-American forward James Worthy, and a supporting cast that included a UNC freshman named Michael Jordan, who would hit a shot later in the season to give the ACC its third national title. For more than 32 minutes, America got what it wanted. Fast-paced, action-packed excitement with the game's brightest stars. Worthy, the eventual MVP, had 16 points. Sampson had 10. With North Carolina leading 44-43, everyone anticipated another one of the ACC's fantastic finishes. Some say what happened next was another one of those moments in ACC tournament history that brought about a fundamental change in the game. This time, the shot clock. With 7.5 minutes remaining, UNC's Dean Smith tried to pull Virginia out of a zone. The Cavs didn't bite, and the resulting delay lasted into the game's final minute. The Tar Heels preserved the 47-45 victory when Virginia's Jimmy Miller lost the ball out of bounds in the final seconds.
And we pulled out, they wanted Sampson to stay underneath the basket. Well, that's the way the game's going to end. And fortunately, we won.
The Tar Heels marched on to New Orleans, where they won their second national title.
Sure enough, by the time the 83 tournament rolled around, there were two significant rule changes in league play that year, the 30-second shot clock and the three-point line. Most felt that they were enacted in order to put the game back in the hands of the little men. It was being dominated by big guys year after year. As a little guy on the 83 NC State Wolfpack team, I didn't mind a bit, and neither did our team. When we arrived in Atlanta for the tournament that year, we were kind of a throwback to the old days, when the one bid per conference rule made it a life and death situation for every team in the league. Everyone felt that the 83 pack had to win a tournament title just to get an NCAA invitation. Fortunately for us, we had a coach who believed we could do that. Jim Valvano had a great sense of ACC history and big ideas for the future. In fact, this room right here called the Room of Dreams at NC State was born out of one of those ideas during the tournament back in 1983. Come tournament time, Jim Valvano lit up. He loved it. March Madness was his time of the year, and he had a theory he wanted his team to live by. Survive and advance. Play hard enough, pull out all the stops in one game just to be able to suit up the very next day. Back in 1983, Jim Valvano was a dreamer, and he had a team that believed in him.
He was the type of coach that we would probably run through a wall if he told us. I mean, we got that to that point where we believed in him so much and we loved him so much that we'd do anything for him.
Somehow, the 83 Wolfpack team did survive and advance. In the ACC tournament and all the way to the ACC's second straight national championship. And it all started out on that March weekend in the Omni. Known as the Cardiac Pack, the Wolfpack lived up to their nickname in the tournament by winning one game in overtime and the other two by the grand total of 4 points. In the 81-78 championship win over Virginia, State got help from everywhere, from everyone. Sidney Lowe, the Case Award winner. All-ACC forward Thurl Bailey, Derek Wittenberg, Lorenzo Charles, and even a young sophomore from Joliet, Illinois, who chipped in 12 points, all on three-pointers. The 83 Wolfpack didn't realize it at the time, but they started a couple of exciting tournament trends. First, only three of the next 10 tournament winners were number one seeds, proving once and for all that everyone has a chance when the calendar turns to March. Also, the Pack's cliffhanger mentality seemed to stick in Atlanta. The three title games played there have been decided by a total of 9 points. It was the way Jim Valvano thought the ACC tournament was supposed to be.
We talk about the history of it and how special it would be. You get four chances to participate in it. As a coach, if you're fortunate enough to coach in this league for 15, 20, you might have 15, 18. As a player, you get four.
Of course, if you're both a player and a coach, you get even more chances to win an ACC championship. Charles Lefty Drizel, who played at Duke in the early 50s and coached at Maryland from 1970 through 1986, may have individually epitomized the significance and greatness of the ACC tournament as much as the 83 NC State team did. He spoke often and openly about how important the ACC tournament was to him and his teams. He yearned for the Maryland Pep Band to blare their trademark Hail to the Chief for him just one time after an ACC title. Yet five times Lefty had been to the ACC championship game with the Terps, and five times the Terps had gone home losers. Still, heading into the 84 tournament, the cold hard facts weren't enough to keep Lefty down.
If I'd have won those five games, y'all probably say I was, you know, greatest tournament coach in the world. And that it, we've lost those five, I guess, you know, say, why come Lefty can't win the tournament? It just had a little bad luck. And, you know, the law of averages is with us this year, so we'll probably walk away with it.
In 1984, Lefty was finally right. The Terrapins captured their first ACC title since way back in 1958 by defeating NC State, Wake Forest, and Duke behind the spectacular play of forward Len Bias. Maryland's 6'8 forward, who averaged 19 points on 60% shooting, became the first of only two sophomores to earn MVP honors with a sparkling display of powerful moves. Bias's spectacular performance assured that Drizel, perhaps the original good old boy of the ACC, would not finish his career without the one trophy he wanted more than just about any other.
And I remember him saying, when I was younger, if I won this thing, I was going to take the trophy and put it on my car and drive all around North Carolina. But now I'm too old for that. And then he talked for an hour about how much it meant. He was trying to say it didn't mean all that much now because he was older and more mature. And then he talked for an hour nonstop about what it meant to finally win the tournament.
Perhaps only one person's quest for an ACC title could have been more sincere and dramatic than Drizel's. By the time the tournament returned to Atlanta in 1985, Georgia Tech was entering its sixth year in the conference. Up-and-coming Yellow Jacket coach Bobby Kremins didn't know whether to laugh or cry when he heard people saying the ACC tournament was no longer important because of the enlarged NCAA field. To Kremins, who suffered that painful loss in the ACC finals as a player in 1970, nothing could have been further from the truth.
What makes it still great is the tradition of the ACC tournament. Again, the fact that you cannot be called ACC champions unless you win the tournament. I think that keeps the pressure alive, and I know it keeps the pride factor alive.
When Kremins and the Yellow Jackets rolled the victory in front of the hometown fans, Tech became the eighth school to earn ACC basketball's highest achievement. Against a strong field in which every ACC team continued on to postseason play, Kremins led the Ramblin' Wreck to the elusive ACC title that seemed to exorcise the basketball demon that had been lurking within him for the past 15 years.
The first 85 ACC championship, it gave me a chance to get some redemption. I always regretted not being part of an ACC championship team. It was always something that bothered me personally. It was something I just felt like was missing in my life. It was something that I thought was definitely going to happen that never did happen. And now I remember thinking before the game, I got a chance to be part of an ACC championship team. And my players put me in that position. And so it was great when we finally did win that game. Now I could put the loss as a player behind me.
The 1986 tournament in Greensboro gave another ACC coach and a whole group of seniors a chance to get a different miserable memory out of their systems. Six-year Duke head coach Mike Krzyzewski and his senior class of Johnny Dawkins, Mark Allery, Jay Billis, and David Henderson had suffered an embarrassing 43-point defeat to Virginia on a forgettable March weekend 3 years before, the worst loss in ACC tournament history. For the next 3 years, the up-and-coming Blue Devils used that horrible night as a landmark.
I guess it's funny now. You're walking out of the Omni and you know that you've been 11-17 and you've just lost by 40 points. And I've never been, had a sickness where people, it's contagious, so people stay away from you. But that night I thought I did, because walking through, lobbies of hotels and all that, you could just, people would kind of shy away and you'd see them talking in corners. And I kind of figured what they were talking about.
Rather than search for new answers to old questions, Krzyzewski and his staff continued to fine-tune the old. And dramatic improvement was the reward as Duke's talent and experience caught up with the rest of the league. By the time they reached the ACC title game against Georgia Tech in 1986, the Blue Devils were ranked number one in the nation. But they knew they had to take one more big step to come full circle from that crushing defeat in 1983.
I think it would have been devastating had we not won that game, because we put so much into it. And basically we put our whole 4 years into that one season. And that would have been a tough one to go on from had we not beaten Georgia Tech in that ball game.
When Duke held on to beat Tech 68-67 for the ACC title, it had all the appropriate dressings. Krzyzewski had his first conference championship. Dawkins, the All-American senior, won MVP honors. And Allery, Billis, and Henderson combined for 30 points and 20 rebounds on their way to the NCAA championship game.
The tournament is probably a good gauge to judge that great class, in that it started from the very, very bottom and it finished at the very top. And they built a lot of character in between.
In 1987, the tournament moved back to the Cap Center, the site of Virginia's upset win in 1976. This year's number six seed, Jim Valvano's NC State team, was only 17-14 entering the tournament and needed a three-game miracle similar to their 1983 cardiac pack run to make the NCAA field.
The one thing that I always felt comfortable in is being in a situation where nobody thought we could win. We did that in 83, and here was the same situation. So the locker room was really kind of electric.
In the first round, the Wolfpack needed one overtime period to beat defending champion Duke. In the semifinals, it took two overtimes to top seven-seeded Wake Forest. Finally, the Pack ran into top-seeded North Carolina, which had completed the ACC regular season undefeated, beating State by 17 and 18-point margins. Valvano hoped for one more miracle, and he got it when guard Vinny Del Negro, a reserve for much of the year, scored 12 points and hit two clutch free throws with 14 seconds left to ice the Pack's 10th ACC title and Valvano's second.
That was one of the great runs I've had, though. I'm talking about running onto court afterwards. That was unadulterated joy and emotion, reminiscent of 83, but this one was even more difficult because I was a lot fatter. You see, I had to carry more weight out there, jumping on people. It was a great, great win for our kids.
The Wolfpack proved once again there is almost nothing an ACC underdog won't try when March rolls around. But just in case there were any doubts about how seriously the conference heavyweights took the ACC tournament 35 years after its inception, the 1988 and 89 title games put them to rest. Arch rivals and national powerhouses Duke and North Carolina, two teams already assured of going to the NCAA tournament, played 80 minutes of intense, tenacious basketball. The championship game slugfest revolved around a pair of All-Americans, Duke's Danny Ferry and North Carolina's J.R. Reed. Both players made first-team All-Tournament both years, and each stepped up their play when the opponents were wearing that other blue.
It was really exciting games for us to play against those guys, because we didn't really care for Duke players too much, and I don't think they cared for us too much. So it was always a real physical game, real emotional game.
In 88, Ferry earned MVP honors for the Blue Devils with 19 points and 10 rebounds in the championship game, but it was the Duke defense that turned the tide. In the last 11 minutes and 45 seconds, UNC made just one of 12 field goals and turned the ball over six times. Still, the Blue Devils needed a pair of free throws from point guard Quinn Snyder with 4 seconds left to clinch the victory. The intensity in those last moments was something that left a lasting impression on observers and participants alike.
I got down in front of them and I said, and you could just feel the crowd. It was a neat setting. I said, fellas, just for a few seconds, just listen and feel. Don't look, just listen and feel. And this is one of those times that many, many players and coaches never have. And I want you to enjoy it.
1989 was more of the same, except Reed and the Tar Heels were able to turn the tables on their nearby rivals with a little defense of their own. It all started with Reed, who had 14 points and 9 rebounds in UNC's 77-74 title game win. But Reed may have earned his MVP honors with his yeoman's work defending his old nemesis and the eventual National Player of the Year, Danny Ferry.
Coach Smith asked me at the end of the game who I wanted to guard. And if he put me on Ferry, would I be able to stay out of foul trouble? And I said, yeah, because if we lose this game and Ferry has a big game, I want it to be my fault.
The tournament returned to Charlotte in 1990 for the first time in 20 years. Ironically, 1990 was the only year between 1984 and 93 in which neither Duke nor UNC reached the title game. Instead, the championship game came down to a matchup between two teams that had only two ACC titles between them, Virginia and Georgia Tech. It also came down to a shootout that illustrated a growing emphasis on the three-point shot. Between them, the Cavaliers and the Yellow Jackets attempted a record 50 threes in the title game alone. That kind of shootout suited the Ramblin' Wreck just fine, with their lethal weapon three lineup of Kenny Anderson, Dennis Scott, and Brian Oliver. The Jackets hit a record 20 three-pointers in the tournament, 10 in the championship game. Oliver, a senior who connected on 7 of 16 threes and averaged 23 points over three games, ended his ACC career with MVP honors.
To have that type of fulfillment was wonderful. To be able to stand up on top of the chairs and have thousands of Tech fans screaming at you, to have teammates hauling you up in the air and parading around with you, that's something that makes you realize that you're truly blessed, one, but then that's a type of fulfillment that you'll never, ever, ever forget.
The 1991 and 92 tournament signaled a return of the still-burning Duke Carolina competitive fires. The names and faces of the players had changed, but Krzyzewski and Smith were back at it during a three-year stretch that would see the two schools capture the ACC's 5th, 6th, and 7th national championships. 91 and 92 were Duke's years in the NCAAs, but the Tar Heels put a large blemish on the Blue Devils' late-season surge in 91, with a resounding 96-74 victory in the tournament final. MVP Rick Fox poured in 25 points over the wilted Duke defense as the Tar Heels marched to their record 12th ACC title. As it always seems in the Duke-Carolina rivalry, one year's loser struck back a year later with the same vengeance the winner showed the previous year. Blue Devil National Player of the Year Christian Laettner knocked in 25 points and added 10 rebounds to earn the Everett Case Award. And point guard Bobby Hurley notched a title game record 11 assists as Duke paraded to its 9th conference championship. The two-year renewal of the Duke-UNC title games also signaled a brief halt to an amazing trend. Before 1991, 20 of the previous 21 championship games had been decided by less than 10 points. The 92 tournament also welcomed league newcomer Florida State and head coach Pat Kennedy into the fold. The Seminoles, as the second seed, won their first tournament game by beating NC State, but lost to UNC in the semifinals. Nevertheless, they enjoyed the new experience.
You know, for us being the new guy on the block and going into the tournament, the media exposure was incredible. I mean, I'd been in the NCAA tournament. The media exposure of the tournament was actually bigger than the tournament unless you get to the, you know, round of eight and the final four.
In the 1993 tournament, North Carolina was the team making the most noise. The nation's number one team swept through the first two games to take on a surprise finalist, number 6 seed Georgia Tech. While the Yellow Jackets were the underdogs, the Tar Heels would be shorthanded. Their star point guard, Derek Phelps, was injured in a semifinal game against Virginia.
And I remember telling our team, look, we have no control over Phelps' injury. Let's just go out there and play for a championship. We're here to play for a championship, and let's go play for a championship. And that's exactly what they did. They played great basketball.
It stayed close, but Tech upset the Tar Heels behind the great play of James Forrest, who was chosen the tourney MVP. It was Bobby Kremins and the Yellow Jackets' third ACC title. North Carolina, though, went on to sweep through the NCAAs to give the ACC its seventh national championship.
A lot has changed over the past 40 years. This very Charlotte Coliseum with over 23,000 seats didn't even exist back in the days when they were calling State's Reynolds Coliseum the Taj Mahal of the country. Everett Case would be mobbed today if he were to come out here in the lobby and hand out tournament tickets like he did back in 1954. And remember those $6 passes? They now go for $140 a piece. They've become so popular at ACC schools that they haven't been sold to the general public since 1966. In fact, that same ACC basketball tournament that was the scourge of critics nationwide in years past has become the tournament by which all others are measured, the perfect blueprint for conferences around the country. Of course, for now, it is still an ideal which they can chase, but never quite catch. Amazingly, as the NCAA tournament has grown, the ACC tourney has kept pace, with many of the nation's top athletes converging on this part of the country and living to experience the pressure and pride involved with the schoolyard rivalries and backyard disputes that match no others. Indeed, today, all signs point to a tournament that will continue to grow well into the 21st century, into an amazing creation that maybe even Everett Case himself could not have imagined more than 40 years ago.